I don't think I've ever had more people tell me to watch an anime more than JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. And it's beyond just like, hey, you should watch this. Like, and it's beyond Barack Obama tweeting at me and tweeting at others saying watch JoJo's. Code Sly tells me, oh, JoJo's is not an anime. It's an experience. And Mr. Gohan, a lot of other people are like, dude, you got to watch JoJo's. So I have indeed watched JoJo's. I watched JoJo's Bizarre Adventure Part 1 and a little bit of Part 2, but I want to focus on Part 1 here on this video and give you guys my thoughts on JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. For those who want to know, I did watch it over on Verve. My partner, VRV.co/geekdom, gets you 30 free days with Verve, and you want to try it and watch JoJo's on there because it's in high quality, it looks great, and there's other anime on there as well, but I chose to watch it on Verve. Now, again, I watched Part 1. Now, to clarify for those who may not know, okay, because some people don't understand, Season 1 of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, this is the modern anime, the one that came out in 2012, I believe. The way they structured this is the first season is actually Part 1 and Part 2. Phantom Blood and Battle Tendency, those are the names for the parts. And those of you who may not know this, you know, the original manga, the original story was written by Hirohiko Araki, and he split up his stories into parts. So, like, the way JoJo's is structured is you have different parts, and they're kind of different stories telling a different generation of the Joestar family. And it goes on from there, Part 1, Part 2, Part 3, etc. Of course, the manga is up till, I think, Part 8 right now, but the anime is only at Part 6, I believe. And, you know, they're all kind of self-contained stories, but the reason why Season 1 has Part 1 and Part 2 because they do kind of go together. It is a continuation. You find out more about what happens in Part 1. Like, you find out more backstory and lore of Part 1 in Part 2, even though it's in a different time. So I want to focus on watching Part 1, which is episodes 1 through 9 of JoJo's. They aired back in 2012 and in 2013. And just to clarify also, I had never known that they had brought JoJo's Bizarre Adventure back, because I actually, a long time ago, I saw the original OVAs way, 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 way back. I'm pretty sure I have very vague memories of it, but I remember watching the OVAs way, way back in the day. But this newer anime is of much higher quality. I mean, that's the thing about this anime. The first thing you'll notice is the art style. Araki has a very distinct art style that does not look like your traditional anime. A lot of anime focuses on characters that kind of have either the Go Nagai look or the Astro Boy kind of look, the cartoonish or the uber realistic, but Araki's style is extremely artistic, the way he draws his characters, to where they do look more human than other anime would. And there's a lot of, the thing about Part 1 is a lot of folks were telling me like, oh, no, you can skip Part 1. And then other fans, hardcore ones, are like, no, don't skip it. Look, I am glad I did not skip Part 1. A lot of people were saying that Part 1's the worst one, or the least good one. And I'll be honest with you, if Part 1 is the least good, then everything coming after Part 1 should be absolutely amazing, because I had a good time watching Part 1. There were a few episodes in the middle that I thought were dragging a little bit, but overall, Phantom Blood, to me, was a great experience. And the thing about it is, and I'm going to go into spoilers here in a minute, okay? I want to talk about non-spoiler first. Again, the art style might, if you're a traditional anime fan, it's going to look a little bit different, and it's fine. I don't think it's that big of a deal. The music is a very important thing with JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, more so later than even earlier. Araki and the people behind the anime are really big music fans, without question. There are characters that are literally named after bands, named after popular songs, you know, and they're everywhere. More of them come even later on in the series. But even early on, when I watched the beginning of JoJo's and I hear Roundabout as the closing song, I love Roundabout so much. And they have Roundabout as the closing song for the credits, the outro song of JoJo's. And then the intro is epic. The intro is one of the most epic anime intros ever, for Part 1. It was just so incredible. The song, I think, is called The Blood's Destiny, right? Performed by Hiroaki Tominaga. And just, I had a great time watching it. So, okay, before we go into spoilers, if you haven't seen Part 1, log on to Verve, or I think it's on Netflix as well, and check it out. Check out Part 1 of JoJo's. It's just the first 9 episodes. That's it, first 9. You can keep going and you probably should keep going, but part one will definitely, it'll definitely shock you. It's very violent. It really, there are a lot of homages to other anime in JoJo's. And I've heard that modern anime has tons of homages to JoJo, so it all kind of balances out. But the first thing that I really noticed about JoJo's Bizarre Adventure Part 1 is how much it reminds me of Fist of the North Star. And it's obvious to me, that there is an influence there. You can't even deny it. The art style is similar but not identical. The fact that you have, you know, Kenshiro, which is the main character of Fist of the North Star, Jonathan Joestar is, and that might be where the whole star thing came from. I mean, it's definitely an influence. Jonathan Joestar is just like him. I mean, it's definitely that whole alpha male 80s shonen feel to it come to life in JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. And JoJo's, the manga, is pretty old, so it all kind of fits into that time frame. Now, Dio, the villain, again, we're not going into spoilers yet, but what a prick. What a terrible person Dio is. I mean, I'm smiling right now because a lot of times when I watch anime, the villains end up being cooler than the good guys in some cases. Like, I'm a big fan of Frieza, of course, even though he is a prick. I love the character. There's a lot of antagonists in anime, like Vegeta became a very popular character in Dragon Ball. Other shows have it to where you have really cool villains, and you end up rooting for them because they're cool. Here, Dio is a freaking horrible person. Like, this entire season, as I'm watching it episode to episode, I'm, like, dying for Dio to lose. I'm waiting for Jonathan to get his hands on Dio. Because, man, I mean, what a horrible, horrible human being, or whatever he is, Dio is. I mean, and they, the anime staff and, you know, Araki, I think, really did a great job of creating a villain that is just so unlikable. Like, everything about him is so unlikable that you root for the good guy to win. And luckily, Jonathan Joestar is a very likable character. I mean, really likable character, and one that you can relate to. And again, remember, it gets even better later on. It's not for everyone, I suppose, so some folks don't like it, but if you're a fan of Shonen, you gotta watch JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. It really is, like, I'm gonna add to that, I'm adding to it, to what everybody's been saying. Watch JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. Now, spoiler time. After you watch the first 9 episodes, come back here, we'll talk about it, okay? Go now. Go watch him now. And if you already have, then stick around. All right. Dude, Dio killed the dog in the first episode. God, I hate this guy. I hated him. See, it's weird because even though it's anime and it's not a real dog, seeing an innocent dog, a puppy, it's not really a puppy, but you know what I mean, a dog getting killed by the villain, like, ruthlessly. He throws him in a damn furnace, dude. And, like, part of me's thinking, okay, this is just cheap heat, but it worked. It effectively worked because I hated Dio to death. Now, I know Jonathan's not the most popular Joestar. I know that there's better ones later on that get a lot more hype from the fandom, but he definitely is an alpha. I mean, he goes out there, he gets himself a woman, takes care of her, you know, and I like how they kind of built it up in the first episode, because there's a time skip from the first to second episode, which was really surprising. It was like, what, 7-year time skip? So it's like, that's rare. You have an episode then a 7-year time skip, but then things get really interesting. You know, when Jonathan meets characters like Zeppeli, and which is like a Led Zeppelin pun, of course, Robert E.O. Speedwagon, which is one of my favorites, and he has to learn, you know, how to unlock his true potential. You know, that's all great stuff. Like, I just love all that. And then the whole thing with the stone mask, I thought was a great idea. And I know I've seen, Araki was influenced by a film, an old film. And if you know what movie this is, please leave a comment down below. I've seen the movie about the mask that makes you into a vampire. There's a movie that has come out about this. It's an old movie. I'm talking about, like, probably like an old black and white film. That Araki got the influence from. But I love watching it and just seeing how much of a nerd Araki is, because he puts in all this music stuff and movie stuff in here. It's like when you watch Dragon Ball, you see Toriyama do a movie reference. You know, it's the same thing. But my God, so the whole thing about learning Hamon, again, the middle episodes were kind of dragged a bit, but by the end, it's incredible. And I will say this, the ending of this story, of episode 9, part 1, dude, that was so sad. That was so freaking sad. I went into this with no spoilers. I didn't know nothing. The only thing I knew is that every subsequent part has a different Joestar, right? A time skip, and they all kind of tie in together, but they have their own kind of self-contained stories, right? Well, I didn't know that fucking... I didn't mean to curse. I didn't know that Jonathan was going to die like the way he did. Like he just... Oh, my God. Like, Jonathan sacrificed himself, and then the baby is, you know, come... You know, she, you know, it's still alive, of course, the next generation of Joestar. But, my God, like, I was not expecting that to happen like that. And he tells his girl, you know, live on. Keep living. You know, that was just... really, really powerful and unexpected. It was only 9 episodes, but it did feel like a great story, start to finish. And part 2, I mean, dog, that all I'm going to say is the Tommy gun. That's all I'm going to say. I'm not going to talk about part 2 until a separate video. I'll be later on. But my God, I'm excited to see where this goes. I heard that it gets better. I haven't been able to catch up with some of the episodes because I've been really busy with my health and things like that. I've been super busy with other projects, but... that being said, I do want to make some more time to finish part 2 and to do part 3 because part 3 is the one that everybody says is the best one, or at least most people talk about Stardust Crusaders as being like the best one or the one that defined the franchise. So I hope it's good. Anyways, that's all I have for you. I hope you enjoyed this little rant about JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. I finally saw it and I liked it. I had a good time. I'll talk to y'all soon.